Good evening. This is Ganzonomy, wishing everybody a happy and a healthy 2022. Tonight's video, we'll go over another box camera. In this case, the Ansco B2 Cadet. The Ansco B2 Cadet is a 1940s box camera that was built by Ansco after the Agfa component was taken over by the US government because Agfa was a German company, and during World War II, German companies were deemed threats. So Ansco became the name brand of many Agfa products in the United States. Ansco is a abbreviation for Anthony and Scoville Company. And it was built in Binghamton, New York. I'm going to go over some of the features and quirks of this camera and let you know what I think of it. So first we can see that it has two viewfinders. You have a portrait viewfinder and a landscape viewfinder. We also have a shutter with one speed, one f-stop, I believe somewhere between f13 and f16. And there's no time or bulb setting. There's no aperture adjustment on this camera. It's literally just a shutter mechanism, some viewfinders, and a winding knob, and of course a film release and a red window. The winding knob, which is up here, is made out of plastic in contrast to the Agfa versions, which were largely made out of metal. The Agfa B2 Cadet being a higher quality cadet than the Ansco version. This higher quality Agfa versus lower quality Ansco seems to carry on into the Sure Shot lineup as well, as Agfa had the Sure Shot and a Sure Shot Special, among other models, which had varying features such as multiple apertures. And in the case of the Special, it could even do close-up focus versus 10 feet to infinity for all intents and purposes. On top, we see it says B2 Cadet. We see the portrait viewfinder. We see the latch to release the back of the camera. This is a very tough latch to release, so I'm going to pause and then release it. But the way that it works is you would pull this up or force it up, and then the back will open. With the back open, we may see that the door says, "For best results, use Ansco B2 film." Don't worry, B2 film is what we call 120 film in the US. It takes a 6x9 negative, so you'd get 8 per roll or 8 6x9 slides if you were shooting something like ektachrome. And the lens itself, so this is a 2.25 by 3.25 camera, and the lens is a simple meniscus design, meaning it has one element. To release the film holder, we simply pull out this knob, and out comes with some semblance of wiggling the film holder. Now, I have two empty spools on here, simply to help it stand up better for this video. But normally you would put a full spool at the bottom, wrap it around, and hook it into the top take-up spool. You would then wind it, holding onto the feeding spool to maintain tension, and then continue winding until you see a large arrow about here. And then put the entirety of the I would call this film folder back into the camera, like so. But this one doesn't seem to want to go back in, but we'll make it go back in. Now that we have the film holder back in, we push the winding knob, close up the back, and we would wind on until we see a number one show up in this little red window. At this point, we know we are ready to shoot our first exposure. Now, with that in mind, I've noticed in the roll of Kodak T-Max 100 that I shot that the one kind of seems to be split, where half of the one is visible on this side, half of the one is visible on this side. So you have to be very careful to look at the numbers when you're shooting. Otherwise, you could either overlap a shot or completely miss a shot and then only have 7 exposures on a roll. Now, I didn't cover this earlier, but this camera is built largely out of cardboard. The only parts that are metal or glass are the frame, the lens, the viewing glasses, one here, the mirrors inside are steel, and on top, up here, this is actually how it looks. This is not messy or dirty or grimy or grungy. It is legitimately a frosted piece of glass on top. That's just how Ansco built them, and I believe it's a cost-cutting measure at the expense of being able to easily see what you're trying to shoot. Lastly, the handle is built out of, looks like, paper. So this is not a camera that I would recommend holding by its handle if you see one in the year 2022, because the handle may not be substantial and you don't want to drop the camera because the handle gave out after almost 80 years. So, I am personally a fan of this camera because this is more in line with what a box camera should be. It's simple, it's fun, it doesn't require a lot of thought, and it's not necessary to have much knowledge of photography beyond simply loading, unloading, and aiming the camera. Whereas other box cameras that I've reviewed require a knowledge in composition as well as a knowledge in how to actually work a camera, which this one doesn't. From what I saw in some ads, it appeared to be worth about $2 in the early 1940s. So this would be about somewhere around $25 to $30 in today's money. So it's even now not a particularly expensive camera if we adjusted for inflation. And I believe that was because that was the intention. This was supposed to be a cutthroat Kodak, meaning cut price. It was supposed to be less expensive than a Kodak Brownie, but you would get a less clear, a more obscured viewfinder, fewer controls, more plastics and less metal, and more cardboard and less metal. I do plan on doing a comparison video between this camera and my number two Brownie, and possibly even compared to my Box Tangor. I hope you enjoyed this video. I hope you found it entertaining and informative. Please do feel free to leave comments. I do read and respond to them. Please also subscribe to my channel. I would like to wish everybody a happy and a healthy 2022, and that we all get through this healthy and we all get through this together. Thank you.